From the JAMA Network, this is JAMA Clinical Reviews, interviews and ideas about innovations in medicine, science, and clinical practice.
I'm Dr. Kristin Walter, Associate Editor at JAMA and a pulmonary critical care physician. I'm joined today by Dr. Anthony Charles, who is Chief of the Division of Trauma, Critical Care, and Acute Care Surgery, Director of the ECMO Program, and Director of Global Surgery at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Dr. Charles is also an associate editor at JAMA. We will be discussing the article that Dr. Charles co-wrote with Dr. Jared R. Gallagher, entitled Acute Cholecystitis, a Review, which was published in the March 8, 2022 issue of JAMA. Thank you for joining us, Dr. Charles.
Thank you very much, and I'm happy to be here.
To start off, approximately how many people in the U.S. are diagnosed with acute cholecystitis each year?
Approximately 200,000 people are diagnosed with acute cholecystitis in the United States.
And the most important risk factor for acute cholecystitis is the presence of gallstones. Can you discuss how many people in the U.S. are estimated to have gallstones and what percentage will go on to develop acute cholecystitis over their lifetime?
Close to 25 million people currently have gallstones in the United States, but only approximately 20% of those patients will actually become symptomatic of any sort of gallbladder issues. Within those, approximately 5% will end up having acute cholecystitis.
So it sounds like there are a lot of people walking around with gallstones. What are some important risk factors for gallstones?
First of all, patients with hemolytic anemias, particularly sickle cell disease and thalassemia, have an increased risk of having gallstones. Obesity is a known risk factor, but interestingly, also rapid weight loss. If you lose approximately 25% of your weight within a year, you'll have a higher chance of having gallstones. There are some medications that have been known to be associated with the formation of gallstones, and those are things like octreotide or hypoglycemic medications, particularly the newer glucagon-like peptide analogs like exenatide and liraglutide. So those will be the main risk factors for gallstone formation.
And what about difference in sex and also pregnancy?
Certainly. So gallstones are more likely in women than in men. But as you age, by the time you're over 65, these differences go away. And of course, pregnancy is a known risk factor for gallstones. The exact etiology of why pregnancy causes gallstones is not very clear. But in the prenatal period and also in the postpartum period, there's a high chance of having gallstones or biliary sludge, which is this combination of mucus and cholesterol crystals within the gallbladder.
And in terms of pathophysiology, your article discusses how after a gallstone obstructs the cystic duct, acute cholecystitis progresses in three distinct phases. Can you describe those phases for us?
Certainly. There's the acute phase in which you have initial sort of gallbladder wall congestion and edema, and this typically lasts 2 to 4 days from the onset of symptoms. This then can then progress into what is what I'll call a hemorrhagic phase in which you have blood within the wall of the gallbladder, and that can potentially lead to necrosis of the wall of the gallbladder. In some patients, this may perforate, particularly the area of necrosis and ischemia. And then the third phase, of course, is after you are roughly around about 3 to 5 days after the onset of symptoms, you may end up going to what I call a chronic or a purulent phase. And this is characterized by leukocyte infiltration, pus within the gallbladder, and gross infection within the gallbladder wall. Typically, these patients will have the omentum stuck to the gallbladder, and they are less sick at this point in time. And this, the third phase occurs on day 6 and later.
And how would you define acute complicated cholecystitis?
Acute complicated cholecystitis is essentially a patient that has acute cholecystitis that has resulted in either gangrene, that is the gallbladder wall is dead, has a gallbladder wall perforation resulting in biliary peritonitis, or has essentially a cholecystoduodenal fistula, that is the gallbladder has now attached itself to the duodenum and stones have gone across, and then they have what we call a gallstone ileus, that is the stone is now causing a small bowel obstruction. Those will be the sort of the complicated cholecystitis in which the management are slightly more challenging.
And now I'd like to shift to acalculous acute cholecystitis. How common is this condition and what are some risk factors for acalculous cholecystitis?
So acalculous cholecystitis typically occurs between 5 and 10% of the population. The risk factors are essentially patients in the critical care setting, critically ill patients. They're in the ICU for other non-biliary related reasons, either following major trauma, major burns. Being on a total parenteral nutrition is a risk factor for acalculous cholecystitis. Those will be the main risk factors, but other things such as, you know, haven't had cardiopulmonary bypass will be a reason to have acalculous cholecystitis.
And just to clarify, that represents about 5% of all acute cholecystitis cases?
Correct.
And what is thought to be the pathogenesis of acute cholecystitis without a gallstone? Because certainly with gallstone, it makes sense. There's a blockage of the duct. But what is the pathogenesis of this disease?
Certainly. What typically happens is that you have bile stasis. So imagine, if you will, a patient's in the ICU, he's not being fed orally. The bile in the gallbladder essentially just sits there. You don't get the normal squeeze to eject bile from the gallbladder. The gallbladder distends. And with this distension, you essentially compress the blood vessels to the wall of the gallbladder. And some people actually believe that you actually have some associated endothelial injury secondary to the inflammation caused by the bile stasis that you started off with. And that's what we think causes it. It is very hard to say, but that's a presumptive hypothesis regarding how acalculous cholecystitis occur. More importantly, these patients have other reasons to have endothelial injury. They're usually in the ICU for sepsis or for trauma or for burn. And this can result in a hypoperfusion state. And that clearly would reduce the blood supply to the wall of the gallbladder. And hence, you may end up having acalculous cholecystitis with inflammation of the wall of the gallbladder.
Interesting. In terms of the diagnosis of acute cholecystitis, ultrasonography is considered the initial imaging modality of choice. Can you describe the diagnostic accuracy of ultrasound for acute cholecystitis and what some typical findings are on ultrasound?
So certainly. So the ultrasound is actually preferred as the first modality because it is non-invasive and it is relatively low cost and easily accessible, and most, nearly all hospitals will have it, and there's no ionizing radiation associated with it. The sensitivity for diagnosis of acute cholecystitis is about 81%. And the specificity is about 80% in acute cholecystitis. The signs of acute cholecystitis on ultrasound include pericholecystic fluid, which is essentially fluid around the gallbladder. The gallbladder will be distended. You'll see edema of the gallbladder wall, and gallstones or sludge may be seen. And that those are the typical signs of acute cholecystitis on ultrasonography.
And what are some other imaging modalities that may be used for diagnosis of acute cholecystitis, and when should they be used?
Certainly, if a patient has signs or symptoms of acute cholecystitis and ultrasound does not give you the typical findings, the alternative include a CT scan of the abdomen and pelvis looking at the right upper quadrant. A CT scan may be used. The gallstone detection of a CT scan is dependent on the type of gallstones that are present. If they're cholesterol stones, they may not essentially light up. And also on CT scan, depending on the thickness of the slices on the CT scan, you may actually miss stones on the gallbladder. However, a CT scan may also show your thickened gallbladder wall, pericholecystic fluid, fat stranding around the gallbladder. The hepatobiliary scintigraphy is actually regarded as the gold standard, also known as a HIDA scan. And essentially, this is a test in which a radio tracer, technician-labeled radio tracer, is injected into the patient, and the patient should have been fasting for 4 to 6 hours. And effectively, if the patient has got a patent cystic duct, the gallbladder will light up on the scan, which means the patient does not have acute cholecystitis. If the patient has acute cholecystitis, the gallbladder will not be visualized. And this is a very, very sensitive and specific test for acute cholecystitis. The sensitivity is about 96% and the specificity is about 90%. Other tests that potentially can help you is the MRI, magnetic resonance imaging, or an MRCP. MRI of the gallbladder will show gallstones, may show gallbladder wall thickening, gallbladder wall distension, fluid around the liver. and pericardial cystic fluid, and any single one of the signs is suggestive of acute cholecystitis. The MRI has a sensitivity of 88% and a specificity of 89%. The importance of the MRCP lies in the fact that if there are other concomitant issues in the biliary system, such as choledocholithiasis, that is stones within the common bile duct, you may see this, and this may help assist in planning the therapeutic approach. But all in all, ultrasound is the first test that you should get, and hepatobiliary scintigraphy is the gold standard.
In terms of treatment, cholecystectomy is the recommended treatment for calculus acute cholecystitis, and the laparoscopic approach is the standard of care in the U.S. Can you discuss the benefits of doing an early cholecystectomy within 1 to 3 days of onset of symptoms versus later?
Certainly. In the past, there was a belief that if a patient shows up with acute cholecystitis, perhaps one should wait to let the inflammation cool down. But there's been several studies and randomized clinical trials that have shown that undergoing laparoscopic cholecystectomy within 24 hours of admission is beneficial. One, the patient spends less time in the hospital, your complication rates are lower, recovery is quicker, and the infectious process is limited. This was when we compare early versus delayed, and delayed is typically defined as having your cholecystectomy approximately 3 days after admission. There's a significant advantage to having your gallbladder removed early.
And what percentage of cholecystectomies that start with a laparoscopic approach end up being converted to an open cholecystectomy?
Approximately 2 to 15% of patients undergoing laparoscopic cholecystectomy will be converted to an open cholecystectomy.
And are there certain risk factors that make it more likely that a cholecystectomy will need to be converted from a laparoscopic to an open approach?
Those in the delayed cholecystectomy group are more likely to be converted to open, being male, being of older age, having a high body mass index, are all higher risk factors for undergoing conversion from laparoscopic to open. But for us in surgery, one of the greatest risk factors is having a prior abdominal operation. So if you have an upper midline abdominal incision, given the adhesions that may occur in the midline and also in the right upper quadrants, this increases your chances of undergoing a conversion from laparoscopic to open cholecystectomy. And then lastly, having a complicated acute cholecystitis increases your chances of conversion to open.
And then shifting to pregnant individuals, is there anything different about their management for acute cholecystitis that you'd like to discuss?
Non-gynecological surgery occurs in approximately 1% to 2% of pregnant patients, and a lot of the abdominal surgeries are going to get things like acute appendicitis and cholecystectomy. In the first trimester of pregnancy, you're going to treat the patients the same. Some people have always felt that you should try and avoid an abdominal operation if you can in pregnancy, but when it comes to acute cholecystitis, the current guidelines from the American College of Obstetrics and Gynecologists and the Society of the American Gastrointestinal and endoscopic surgeons recommends laparoscopic cholecystectomy be performed after acute cholecystitis in any trimester of pregnancy in the presence of acute cholecystitis.
And what about elderly patients with acute cholecystitis? Should they receive any different treatment than standard treatment?
Elderly patients should undergo standard treatment. I think the decision in the elderly is really clouded by any associated comorbidities that they may have. Most people actually would suggest that you should go ahead and remove an elderly, and when we say elderly, so age over 65, some people may not think that is old, and so we'll just call them older patients, age over 65. There's a survival benefit to going ahead and removing their gallbladder as opposed to any other alternative therapeutic strategies.
And another important point that was brought up in your review was the use of antibiotics in acute cholecystitis. Can you discuss the recommended use of preoperative and postoperative antibiotics?
Certainly. Once the diagnosis of acute cholecystitis is made, prior to your laparoscopic cholecystectomy, patients should be placed on IV antibiotics. Typically, the commonest organisms are gram-negatives, E. coli, Klebsiella, and those patients were placed on combination antibiotics such as amoxicillin, tazobactam, and in the pre-surgery period or the preoperative period, antibiotics should be given. In the operating room, you can also give antibiotics before you start the case. Postoperatively, there is no evidence that prolonged antibiotics or any antibiotics after the gallbladder has been removed is beneficial.
And certain patients with acute cholecystitis have a high perioperative risk, either due to critical illness or because they have multiple medical comorbidities. Can you discuss the option of percutaneous cholecystostomy tube placement?
In patients with acalculous cholecystitis or patients that are critically ill with calculous cholecystitis, given their critical illness and their significant operative risks, percutaneous cholecystostomy tube has always been an option. Essentially, that is putting a tube through the liver into the gallbladder to decompress the gallbladder and try and sort of drain any sort of purulence within the gallbladder has been thought to provide a survival advantage. In reality, patients being managed in the presence of calculous cholecystitis, being managed with percutaneous cholecystostomy tube, do worse. They have a higher mortality, higher infection, have a higher reoperative rates eventually than patients who you just take to the operating room and do a laparoscopic cholecystectomy or an open cholecystectomy. So by and large, with calculous or acalculous cholecystitis, laparoscopic cholecystectomy, possible open cholecystectomy is the way to go. There's a small subset of patients, particularly patients with acalculous cholecystitis, in which surgery is significantly prohibitive. Those patients may benefit from a percutaneous cholecystostomy tube placement, but this should be the exception rather than the rule.
Is there anything we haven't discussed about acute cholecystitis or its management that you'd like to mention to our JAMA audience?
Certainly, there appears to be a significant disparities in patients presenting with acute cholecystitis in the United States. Underrepresented minority patients tend to present later, and this could be due to access of the healthcare system, and hence they were more likely to present with complicated cholecystitis. But by and large, I think early laparoscopic cholecystectomy should be the standard of care.
That was Dr. Anthony Charles, who is Chief of the Division of Trauma, Critical Care, and Acute Care Surgery, Director of the ECMO Program, and Director of Global Surgery at the University of North Carolina in Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Thank you for sharing your thoughts with us about this important topic.
Thank you very much. It was my pleasure.
This is Dr. Kristin Walter. Thank you for listening. This episode was produced by Daniel Morrow at the JAMA Network. The audio team here also includes Jesse McCorders, Shelley Steffens, Lisa Harden, Audrey Foreman, and Mary Lynn Perpoluk. Dr. Robert Golub is the JAMA Executive Deputy Editor. To follow this and other JAMA Network podcasts, please visit us online at jamanetworkaudio.com. Thanks for listening.